Good morning. I'm Pastor Cheryl Taylor, and in the name of the God who was, who is, and who is to come, I welcome you to worship this morning at First Presbyterian Church of Rockwall. Hear now these words from Psalm 56. O Most High, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust, I am not afraid. I want to thank you for choosing to join us in worship this morning. And I also invite you to check out our other video offerings, Weekday Word and Time for Young Disciples, on both YouTube and Facebook. And kids, if you saw this week's Time for Young Disciples and you've made palm branches, now would be the time to go and get them so that you can take and have a palm parade when the song starts in just a few minutes. Parents, if you happen to take photos of your kids processing around with their palms, I hope you'll share those photos with us. During this Holy Week, I also hope that you'll join us for a Good Friday Tenebrae service. This is a candlelit worship liturgy of shadow and light that traces the path to the cross. The service will post at 7 p.m. on Friday evening on both YouTube and Facebook and will be available on our website as well. Next Sunday, April 12th, I hope you'll join us as we come together to celebrate the power of the resurrection on Easter Sunday. We'll celebrate the Lord's Supper virtually during this 11 o'clock service of worship, so I invite you the bread and juice of your choice available and on hand for that service so that we can all share in the sacrament together. And I also hope that you'll share a picture with us of you with your chosen elements during the streaming of that service. I've been taking and thanking people at the end of each service, and today, at the end of the announcements each week, and today I'd like to give a special shout out to our musicians. I'd like to thank Dan Vaughn, who is our director of music and our incredible organist. He has been putting together wonderful music each week. Pat Sproul, who's been playing piano. Today we have soloist Mary Thacker. We're grateful to her for being here. And in support of her, who is usually our guitarist, but is today sound guy, David Case. Thank you. And last week and this week, you're going to hear a drama reading from David Moore, who is my husband. And we've been trying to limit the number of people in the sanctuary so that we can maintain safe distance. And so he has stepped up and done this, and I want to thank him as well. And now, let us all breathe in. Invite the Spirit's presence. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
Today is traditionally Palm Sunday, but we covered Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem the first Sunday of Lent as we began our entry into the Passion of Jesus. And so this morning we're going to turn to another traditional theme for this day in the church calendar, Passion Sunday. This week we join Jesus in the garden. Gethsemane is the moment when a chain of events begins that cannot be halted. Once Jesus is taken into custody, there's no going back. So we pause a moment with him in the garden just before his arrest, and we feel with him the temptations that arise when facing difficult circumstances, to run, to hide, to use whatever power we have to change things, fight it, to perhaps even bargain with God. Will you join me in prayer? God of presence, we're grateful that you are with us this day, through your word read and proclaimed, through this community gathered in your holy name. By the power of your Spirit, give us the courage to stay close to you and to your Son, Jesus, in the days ahead. Amen. Our gospel reading today is from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 14, verses 32 through 41. And I invite you to listen now for God's word to us this morning. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake for an hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come to the time of trial. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. Once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy, and they didn't know what to say to him. He came a third time, and he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God."
You are Oh, yes, I was there, but I could barely keep my eyes open. Perhaps I'd had a little too much wine. That's been known to happen. Or maybe I was so sleepy because I was just so very tired. This week is taking its toll on me, watching our every step, wondering when the other shoe will drop, afraid that the commotion stirred up about Jesus will result in something terrible. I've been on edge ever since we've gotten here. But oh, that parade. Who would have thought that this man I met on the shores of my fishing spot would turn out to be 3 years of non-stop surprises, and that entrance into Jerusalem was more amazing than all of it combined. I felt sure that I was part of something that was going to change everything. Now, I'm not so sure. Not everyone, it turned out, was so pleased about Jesus' arrival here, and we've been under scrutiny for days. Then tonight at the table, Jesus revealed that one of us was about to hand him over. I'm noticing who is missing here in the garden, and I'm wondering if maybe he was right. My gut turns over at the thought of it. I do not want to face the fact that these people who have become my family could turn against one another under this sort of pressure. Fear threatens our very bonds. So why put ourselves out here in the open? I need to stay awake and keep watch. I've got my sword. I know Jesus told me not to bring it, but come on. All he seems to think we need to do is pray. He asked us to pray with him. Yes, I pray. I'm praying. I'll fervently pray. Okay. But is that really enough? How can God help us if soldiers arrive? And yet, I'm so tired. I'm so sleepy.
Dinner was over, and so the party moved outside, took a leisurely walk up a hill, stretched their legs, settling, finally, at a grove of olive trees where a garden was in bloom. The scent of roses mixed with olive oil from the nearby press filled the air. Sounds pleasant, doesn't it? I'm betting a lot of you are taking after-dinner walks during these days, a chance to be out in nature, to breathe air, air that is much fresher and cleaner than it was when we were all out there driving incessantly. I know many of you are gardening right now because I see the mulch and the annuals going in now that you have time to do it. I see all of this when I'm out on my neighborhood walks. But this walk in today's scripture, in this garden, was different. Instead of a tranquil retreat from the pressures of tension of a risk-filled Passover week in Jerusalem, this garden, called Gethsemane on the Mount of Olives, this garden becomes a scene of distress, agitation, and grief. In this garden, Jesus limits the number of people who go in with him to three, and he maintains physical distance, and then he prays. He prays as if his life depended upon it. That's what this passage is all about, prayer. Prayer in a time of distress. Prayer for hardship to pass. Prayer for deliverance. Prayer we know all too well. In Mark's remembrance of this scene, Jesus is truly human. He's afraid, he's anxious. He wants pain to pass. He wants death to be on the far side of a long life well lived. In prayer, he turns to the parent that he's relied on throughout, the parent whose divine being is a part of him. And in this text, which was originally written in the Greek, he uses the Aramaic word Abba, the familiar for father, the word that a child, either a youth or an adult, would use when calling out to their own parent, but not a word that's often used in ancient Judaism to address God, which is a sign of the intimate relationship Jesus has with God, a relationship developed over the decades through intimate conversations called prayer. I say this all the time, but prayer is simply talking with God. And that's what Jesus does. He opens up his heart to ask for what he desperately wants, even though he knows what the answer will be. How many times have you asked your own parent, mother or father, for something knowing the answer before you can even open your mouth? From, can I have a candy bar at the checkout counter, to, hey, mom, dad, can I borrow the car and drive the gang down to Padre for spring break? To, should I take this job? I mean, the pay is great, but I'm a little concerned about the company's ethics. Fill in your own examples. We all have them. And yet, that doesn't keep us from asking, even when we more than suspect we're not going to like the answer. This is the conversation that Jesus is having in the garden. But the consequences go far beyond candy or a vacation or even a job. Jesus is praying for his life. I don't want to die. It's a prayer that many of our medical professionals and others are voicing each and every day right now. New Testament scholar Amy Jo Levine says that people with mission-critical jobs that place them in danger are right to ask for this cup to pass, and yet they know that they have a vocation, a calling that puts them at risk, and so they move forward. Not their will, but a greater good is honored. That's what Jesus does when he tells God, not what I want, but what you want. And it's not a new prayer for him. After all, he'd already prayed early in his ministry, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that's a prayer that we'll repeat later in today's worship. All this raises the uncomfortable question of God's will. Does God want Jesus to suffer and die? Does God want us to suffer and die? No. I can't help but imagine that this garden talk was excruciating for God, just as our heartfelt prayers right now for relief break God's heart. But in this world, actions have consequences, and those consequences play out. Jesus, in living out the sacrificial love of God for all humanity, he sparked fear in the hearts of those in power, temple elites and Roman rulers as well. God's will is that the world may become as heaven. But the powers of this world, they don't yield control quite so easily, then or now. There's always someone who's got something to protect, who acts, often ruthlessly, at others' expense. That's why Jesus had to die. In the next verses, Jesus goes willingly into the hands of sinners, but he continues to pray, even up to the moment of his death on the cross, where he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? A direct quote, by the way, from the 22nd chapter of that great prayer book of the Bible, Psalms. But God had not forsaken him. God's answer to Jesus' prayers simply hadn't arisen yet. Our faith tells us that God's will is done in the end, that God can resurrect the worst of any situation. It's hard for us to imagine as we move through Holy Week. and I hope you'll join us Friday at 7 as we continue a story that's hard to hear, and yet it's necessary if we're truly to appreciate the good power of the good news that we'll celebrate next Sunday on Easter. My friends, it can be hard for us to envision new life as we shelter in our homes, as the timeline for remaining there continues to lengthen, as businesses founder and jobs evaporate, as more and more people die. And yet, we can learn from Jesus. We can learn that prayer, especially in tenuous times, is vital. We can pour out all that we are, our fears, our anxieties, and our hopes to a God that listens, but whose answers to our prayers may not look like what we asked for. Like Jesus, we pray not to bribe or cajole or to appease a distant God, but to draw on our relationship with our close parent, the parent that we trust no matter what happens, the parent who is there beside us no matter what. Jesus trusted God. He trusted his Abba because they had a deep personal relationship, one that had been nurtured through the decades by authentic conversation, by prayer. This Holy Week, I hope that you will take a walk, stretch your legs, appreciate the gardens that you see along the way. Breathe deeply. And while you're there, admiring the flowers and the trees of God's creation, take a moment to let go of your distress, to offer up your agitation, to be honest, really honest, and ask God for what you want, knowing that the one that we call Lord loves you as a parent because you are God's beloved child, and trusting in the one who sacrificed everything, even life itself, for you. Not because he wanted to suffer and die, but because he wanted to pave the way for you to move beyond suffering and death. Amen. Gratitude is the cornerstone of our Christian faith. We receive the gift of grace through God in Jesus Christ, and we respond to that gift of grace in gratitude, offering ourselves up as witnesses to that grace. Even in times like these, there's so much for which to be grateful. I invite you to take this time to reflect on blessings that arise even in the midst of challenging circumstances and give thanks for them. And if you choose to respond to those blessings by supporting the work of this congregation, the screen will detail how that's possible. I want you to know that we are grateful for you and for this opportunity to be church together. During our prayer time this morning, I invite you to post the names of people and situations you'd like the community to pray for in the comments section of this feed. There, others can see your requests and bring them before God in holy conversation. And now, will you pray with me? God, when we think about all you've sacrificed for us, we're overwhelmed. when we think about the pain you suffered through Jesus and for Jesus, through us and on our behalf, well, it's difficult for us to go there. And yet you call on us to stay with you. You call on us to pray. Draw us close to you and to one another as we come before you this morning, lifting up all those who have contracted COVID-19 and those who have lost loved ones to it. All those who are feeling isolated and lonely, that we may reach out to them during their dark night. All that are giving up hope, that they may see your light. All those who are serving you by serving others during this time of crisis, especially medical workers and first responders, but also grocery clerks and stockers, pharmacists, postal carriers, restaurant workers, and others who are there for us so that our needs may be met. We pray for teachers who are continuing to share your love with children and for the many who are losing their jobs right now. We pray for our world's leaders that they may feel your presence and act upon your will, that all may be valued and cared for as your beloved children. We are bold to pray this day for the family of Fatima Lampkin, who died this week of cardiac arrest. We pray for Jason Mell, who's recovering from COVID-19 in Aspen, for Dan and Elizabeth Vaughn, for Brian Petty and Sally Joe Parisi's nephew, Jason Switzer, as he continues his recovery from cancer surgery. Lord, we pray for your church, that we may draw close to you and to others while physically distant, continuing to serve in your Son's holy name. And we pray now for those we hold in our hearts. Lord, as we enter this week that is set apart, that's holy, we give thanks that you are here beside us, steadfast through the darkness, leading us into the light. Help us to remember and trust in your faithful presence by praying together as your Son modeled for us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we did last week, I'd like to invite you during the benediction to reach out to share the peace of Christ with others by commenting on the feed section of this broadcast. Even if we can't be together in person, even if we can't hug or shake hands, we can still offer each other the living presence of Christ and his peace. And now, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and in the days ahead. Go, my friends, in peace, to be the peace of Christ for others.